The GTX 1050 Ti launched about 6.5 years ago, and you're probably asking, TechArc, why are you reviewing this thing? Well, it can still be found on eBay for cheap these days, and it can still be bought brand new on sites like Amazon. So how does this thing perform in 2023? Find out after this message from our sponsor, HelloFresh. HelloFresh is a meal delivery service that makes cooking easy, fun, convenient, and most importantly, healthy. Take it from Bessie, a mother of three who has had over 100 HelloFresh boxes, who says that HelloFresh takes away the two things I hate most about cooking, planning and shopping. They deliver crisp ingredients and follow-along recipes delivered to your door every week, allowing you to choose from a vast selection of meals and catering to a wide range of preferences and requirements. Two of the many great dishes they offer include cheese pesto and tomato scrolls with cheddar cheese, and Herbie chicken Waldorf-style salad with croutons and lime alola feta. Mmm, yummy. Succulent. And right now, I'm offering you a great deal on your first box of HelloFresh with a 65% discount on your purchase, as well as free shipping. So what are you waiting for? Don't miss out on this opportunity to get an epic discount. Click the link in the video description below to start enjoying healthy and delicious meals today. Now, we tested the 1050 Ti at max settings while the 1080p in all of the 10 games, using TAA where possible. While for our test bench, we used the 5800X3D for the CPU, a 980 Pro for the boot drive, which is also where the games are installed, and a Corsair Vengeance kit of 2x16GB for a total of 32GB at 3600MHz for our RAM. Starting off, we found that the 1050 Ti loses to the 1650 by 32% in average frames per second while playing CSGO. While the game was still playable on the 1050 Ti, we did notice that the 1.1% lows were a bit low. In Cyberpunk 2077 now, we found that the GTX 1050 Ti loses to the GTX 1650 Super by an impressive 49% in average frames per second. This just goes to show the significant performance difference between these two graphics cards. In our test with F122, we found that the 1050 Ti lost to the 1650 Super by 46% in average frames per second. However, the GTX 1050 Ti still provided a consistent experience with tight 1.1% lows, but fell just shy of 60fps. Moving over to Forza Horizon 5, we see that the 1050 Ti loses to the 1650 Super by a whopping 39% in average frames. This results in an overall unplayable experience for the 1050 Ti that falls below 30fps. Moving over to an oldie but a goodie, GTA 5, we see that the 1050 Ti is not only 19% worse in average frames versus the 1650 Super, but the 1.1% lows varied across our testing. Moving over to Hitman 3, we see the GTX 1050 Ti pulls above 30fps, an impressive feat given that this is max settings, but still at 1080p nonetheless. Still, it's a good 51% less than the 1650 Super, which pulls well above the 60fps mark. Moving over to Rainbow Six Siege, the 1050 Ti falls short of 60fps, with the 1650 Super astonishingly smashing the 1050 Ti, with it losing by a staggering 58%. However, it's worth noting that the 1.1% lows were still tight, even though the average FPS was low. In Red Dead Redemption 2, however, the 1050 Ti throws a curveball, with the average frames being only one frame high on the 1650 Super. The 1.1% lows also seem to vary a lot. However, you can just ignore this one, as it might be the result of our testing methodology, using MSI Afterburn's benchmark tool instead of the metrics given in Red Dead Redemption's performance test. We'll make sure next time that we use the game's inbuilt metrics. Moving on to Shadow of the Tomb Raider, much like what we saw in Hitman 3, the 1050 Ti manages a slightly above 30fps experience, with acceptable 1.1% lows. But again, the 1650 Super slaughters it, with the 1050 Ti losing by 46%. Next up is our last game we tested today, Spider-Man Remastered for PC, and a pretty recent title of that. Again, the 1050 Ti loses to the 1650 Super by 46%, but pulls 30 frames per second on average. But like what we saw with GTA 5, the 1.1% lows varied a lot again. On average at 1080p for all 10 games we tested today, the 1050 Ti loses to the 1650 Super by 39%. For average FPS per dollar, you can take the average FPS seen in our average FPS chart and run your own calculations for value, dividing the FPS by the price of the card you find online. The higher the number, the more value there is. But for the current price listed on Passmark, the 1050 Ti provides 9% more value versus the 1650 Super, which is interesting considering the performance we observed. For average power consumption, the GTX 1050 Ti... drew 29% less power as compared to the 1650 Super, which is not surprising at all given the 1050 Ti does not use any supplementary power connectors and draws all of its power directly from the 75W PCIe slot. Lastly, for performance per watt, the 1050 Ti ends up being 15% less efficient, which is surprising given its low power consumption. But at the same time, it's not surprising since the performance was a lot worse than the 1650 Super. Moving over to the benchmarks, starting with 3D Mark Timespy at 1080p, of course, the 1050 Ti got 2,343 points in the GPU score, which is 51% less than the 1650 Super. This lines up well with what we saw in the 10 games we tested earlier. Moving over to a lot more productivity focused test, the Puget Adobe Suite in Premiere Pro, the 1050 Ti scores a mere 51% less than the 1650 Super. This could be because the 10 series lacks the 16 series enhanced encoders, which speeds up Premiere Pro's performance. And in After Effects, the 1050 Ti loses to the 1650 Super by 27%, a lot less because After Effects performance is much more reliant on the CPU performance rather than GPU performance. Now lastly, Photoshop. We can just ignore this one as the points vary a lot. The 1050 Ti pulls ahead of the 1650 Super, which might be because of processor affinity. Photoshop relies on CPU single-threaded performance, so a better GPU wouldn't really impact the performance as much as upgrading a CPU does. To summarize the Puget Adobe scores, the 1050 Ti loses to the 1650 Super by 14%. Again, there is still a difference, but it's not significant. This means again that upgrading your GPU for these specific workloads would not really impact the performance as much as upgrading the CPU would. And to no one's surprise, the 1050 Ti provides 56% more value compared to the 1650 Super. This is because, as I said, the GPU does not really affect much in these instances, so the cheapest GPU would obviously provide the best value here. Next, in average power consumption, the 1050 Ti interestingly drew 40% less power than the 1650 Super. Lastly, in performance per watt, or the GPU score per watt, again, is to no one's surprise that the 1050 Ti loses to the 1650 Super in efficiency by a whopping 38%. So while it does not really matter to have a better GPU for more performance, it might matter to have a more overall efficient GPU. In this case, the 1650 Super does not provide that much more, but is much more efficient at doing the same task. Now for overclocking, we were able to boost the core clock by 200 MHz and the memory by 1000 MHz. While not being able to increase the power limit, after running the Heaven benchmark both before and after overclocking, we found that the average frames increased by 13%. While this is not as high as I was hoping for, it is still a decent improvement. As I mentioned before, the GTX 1050 Ti does not have any supplementary power connections, which could have limited its overclocking potential. The 1050 Ti managed to achieve this overclock without significantly increasing the power draw, core temperature, or fan noise. This is an impressive feat, considering how high the overclock was. However, it's important to note that this card may have been power limited, which could have prevented it from reaching its full potential. In conclusion, despite its age, the 1050 Ti still holds up decently well in 2023, especially considering its low price point compared to more recent cards. While it certainly cannot compete with the higher end cards in terms of performance, it can still provide a playable experience in many popular games with some compromises in graphics settings. However, if you were looking for a significantly better gaming experience, the 1650 Super is the clear winner here. It outperformed the 1050 Ti and all of our tests, and while it's more expensive, the improved performance is certainly worth it if you can afford it. Additionally, the 1650 Super is a newer card, so it is likely to be more future-proof than the aging 1050 Ti. That being said, if you're on a tight budget or just looking for a budget-friendly option, the 1050 Ti can still be a viable choice. It is also worth noting that the 1050 Ti draws less power than the 1650 Super, which can be a consideration for some users. Overall, it is still a solid choice for those looking for a budget gaming PC or an upgrade for an older system without breaking the bank. Anyway, that's all for today. Make sure to like, subscribe, and turn on the notification bell so you don't miss a video we upload. Also, make sure to check out some of our other GPU videos like the 7900 XT review we did.